like the power scene images. And physics did not ask foundational questions to quantum mechanics. Right? So in that sense, this foundational way of looking at a subject comes much after the subject develops. And in some, I would argue that cognitive science is, it's too, we are in the butterfly collecting stage of the subject. So asking foundational questions which are of a mathematical nature is potentially a problem. You're better off at the philosophical foundations rather than the so-called theoretical or mathematical foundation. So philosophical foundations, one very important question would be the importance of experience to the study of the mind. That's a foundational topic. It doesn't have a foundational formulation. There's no universal agreement as to how one should study experience and consciousness. So we are still too far from that stage. In 100 years, maybe we'll be there.
But it could be different, right? Somebody has a number of different kinds of experiences. Mm-hmm. The experience may be different from one another. That makes something different, because if you want to make a foundation, then it could be different from all these things.
Let me throw a certain possibility at you. What if people's experiences are different? In which case, you can't artificially create foundations that make our experiences the same. So any account of, let us take two observations. Number one, everybody's experiences are unique. Number two, any account of consciousness must take this unique character of experience into consideration. Then, whatever theory you have cannot be the same for everybody. I mean, the very nature of what a theory of consciousness then would be different from physics and maths. Because physics or maths theory says stuff that happens there is the same as stuff that happens here. But maybe that's actually not the way consciousness works.
Yeah, but the thing is that our bodies and all the matters in the world, everybody looks like different. But internal structures look very same.
But that's only saying that the mechanical picture of the body is one way. Sorry,
I just want to respond to that. And is it necessary that all disciplines derive their legitimacy from having some such universal foundational notions? For example, one could ask, what are the foundational notions of mind?
For biology.
And within that, one could ask, what are the foundational notions of, say, what we recommend about whose work? One could ask, what are the foundational notions of physics? One could ask, what are the foundational notions of history? And is it necessary that all of these disciplines have written its own foundational axiomatic ideas that we
have? No, my question is that all humans are same.
Internal
structures
look
like same, almost.
No. That's a mistaken assumption. What I'm saying is, you are looking at those aspects of humans that are the same. So if you think of humans as both subjective and objective beings, one argument could be at the extreme of subjectivity, we are maximally different. And at the extreme of objectivity, we are maximally the same. So to say that we are the same is only picking the objective view. It may not actually be the truth about how humans are. I mean, the great advantage of the humanities is we don't have to assume everything is the same. That symmetry assumption is not part of the humanities. Sorry, go back. Let me reformulate your question. I think what you're asking, if I understand it right, is now that we have invented computers, do we now start looking at everything through that lens? Or is there some genuine way or genuine sense in which humans are computers? Okay? Of course, every model is a model. Just as this, what's interesting though is, nobody says the calculus model of physics. Even though, actually, calculus was invented to solve physics problems. But nobody says the calculus model of physics. People say Newtonian physics or relativity or what. All of them use calculus. While when it comes to the mind, somehow the computer has taken on such a central role that we call all of these computational theories in the mind. And there might be a over-marketing of that term, therefore. But that said, and which I will talk about tomorrow, I think, when we talk about the brain a little bit, there are systematic reasons to think that a kind of digital mechanism is in play in information processing in the brain, right? Which is the spiking, spike trends. That itself could be debated if you say that if you think of spike trends as something which are essentially a random signal with average properties rather than bit by bit information processing, then even there you can debate the computational account, but it looks like even a single spike carries information. So what is the foundation of any 0-1 type approach? It doesn't have to be 0-1, but any digital account of the world basically has to be able to say that each symbol, each bit in your coding system has meaning. And if it does, then it is doing something important. And it's doing something different from the next signal and the next signal and so on and so forth. And I think there's some very interesting new work that suggests that indeed our neurons are actually very, very far from, I mean, they're very efficient. They